Welcome to another edition of Talking Business. I'm Joey Trombley, and on the camera is our founding father himself. Coming over to me right now is Calvin Castine. And today our show has taken us to the Woodmen of the World here. We're in Chazy, and this is the lodge that was formed how long ago, Calvin?
The lodge really got active in 1975. Got our first awards ceremony in June of 1975. We awarded Dr. John Southwick our Citizen of the Year Award, and we took off from there, and we haven't looked back since. Our first lodge president was Ed Trombley out of Rouse's Point, and George Cookman was the vice president, and we had a lot of familiar names like Allison Blaine, Patty Hicks, Howard Reed, not the guy associated with the hospital, but Howard Reed from Champlain was at the time was there, and a lot of local folks were involved. And Woodmen is a fraternal organization, as you right. are well aware of, similar in some ways, in many ways, I guess, to the Knights of Columbus, except Knights of Columbus is Catholic men. Mm-hmm. Woodmen's open to the entire community, and it was started back in 1890. And our lodge here, like I said, got active in 1975. And once Ed Trombley got active, one of the first things he wanted to do was get some land. So he, I knew about this place. In fact, it was owned by my brothers Gary and Sam, and they had 30 acres of working land here, plus a whole lot of woodland and so on. And Ed came down, took a look at it, and said, "Hey, we ought to buy this." And the Woodmen went ahead and bought it. And a few years later, we put up this lodge. It's named after Perry Loftus, the late Perry Loftus now, but at the time, he was our state manager out of the Albany area.
Now, what year did the lodge come up?
I would guess fairly quickly, 77 or 78. I couldn't put my fingers on it this morning. It made the cover of our Woodmen of the World magazine at the time. So that would tell me exactly when it was.
Sure.
But 77 or 78. So it wasn't too long after we bought the land that we were able to put up the building. Now I'm thinking about it. I think maybe it was in the very early 80s, I think.
So it's still an active lodge.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Linda Gagneau is the president right now. The past president is my godson, who is no longer in the area. Todd Castine was the immediate past president. And they're very, very active. The flags are probably what a lot of people associate with the women. And, we're going to go down and talk to Dale and Tim Gagneau, and they'll tell us about the business side of it, because mm-hmm. they're both involved in the business side as well as being in the fraternal side. But the fraternal side is very important. This land that we have here on, I don't know if they still call it the Bugby Road or if it's the McAdam Road now, or
McAdam Road
yeah.
right now.
Yeah,
it's a dead end road.
Yeah, it's a dead end road, cut off by the railroad tracks here off the Ridge Road. And a few years back, this road might be more familiar to people as the Scott's Hockey Rink.
Right.
A few years back, the house and the Walter family had both lost sons in car accidents, and both their sons were involved in hockey, and they wanted a place to put up a hockey rink. So they approached the lodge, and I think I was vice president at the time, and one thing I insisted on was that, we can donate the land, but if it doesn't happen, that the hockey rink doesn't happen, that it comes back, the property comes back to the lodge. Mm-hmm. But that was never a concern, because once they took off, those people just,
it was full steam. It's a flourishing rink right now.
Yes.
And when hockey season's in place, you can't even get into that parking lot.
Yeah, so it's been fantastic. It's been a great asset to the community, and donating property like that is, that's what Woodman's all about, trying to help the community. And just to be a small part of that hockey rink is nice.
And you're right, they worked very hard to make it what it is today.
Yeah.
But it started with the donation of the land.
Yeah. It moved along with the donation of the land. It started before that. The concept was there, and these folks took off and ran with it. But so more people are familiar with this road because of the hockey rink than otherwise.
And actually, this lodge, if people go to the hockey rink, it's just past the hockey rink.
Yeah.
I mean, just literally just past it
yeah.
on the left-hand side.
Yeah.
So the people viewing this kind of get an idea where this is located.
Yeah. So the Woodmen is a... As I said, June 6, 1890 is when it was founded, and it's been around for, that's about 123 years, I guess, if you're doing some quick math. So it's been around quite a while. We're probably better known in the South than we are up here in the North, but we've made a, a little bit of a footprint here. One of the things I'm most proud of when I was more actively involved with the Woodmen was the 1980 Olympics, and every American medalist receives an American flag from the Woodmen of the World.
Wow. Now, were you up there to be able to present it?
We went up at the opening when the torch arrived. We were part of the ceremonies there. We presented a flag to the regional organizing committee and left the flags there because it would have been logistically impossible to run in and out of there every time American won a flag. So we left the flags with the local organizing committee, and they presented them. So Eric Hayden and all the guys in that hockey team received an American flag from the Woodmen of the World.
That's really neat. I didn't even know that story, so it's kind of neat for the viewers to see.
That's getting to be a long time ago. It's 33 and a half years ago.
You know? Yeah, it is.
but every day, every year on February 8th, I remember back to being up there in Lake Placid, and it was cold. It was cold. But yeah.
Well, actually, we still had winters back then.
Yeah, but that year there...
It was kind of mild, wasn't it?
Well, it was cold, but we didn't have any snow until just before the Olympics started. They were wondering, will there be any snow on Whiteface?
Yeah. Right, yeah. So we had the snow machines working, I think, back then.
Yeah.
It seems like yesterday, but it really... in some aspects, it seems like it was yesterday.
Yeah.
So we're going to go over and see Dale and Timmy.
I have no idea what they're going to talk about, but I'm sure they'll talk the business side, because this is what? What's the name of the show?
Talking Business.
Talking Business.
Absolutely. So you got the founding father here, Calvin Castine, on camera, a rare sighting of Calvin Castine on the camera.
And I should point out that what we're doing right now started as one of the things that I thought would be good for the community as a Woodman of the World project. The first thing we did... in 82, I saw that there would be this thing called an access channel when the cable came through. And so at that point, I approached the lodge and said, in tapes back then,
right,
on sale were $10 each.
Right.
I said, they're supposedly going to be providing the equipment. We ought to see about getting a show. We could do a ball game, parades, and maybe do a tour of a business once in a while and something like that there. So the lodge members went along with it. And then in 83, when the cable, Champlain New Channels at the time, came in, they finally bought some equipment. They started in 82 was serving homes, but in 83, they finally bought the equipment. So in June of 83, we put on our first program. And I did that for a couple of years. And then in 86, I decided to start Hometown Cable. So it started as a Woodman of the World project. And without the Woodman of the World, without this lodge, we probably wouldn't be standing here right now.
That is amazing when you look at the beginning of that.
Yeah,
huh?
Yeah. So, well, I mean, just there's little things. One thing leads to another. And
well, of course, I remember back in the 70s, Woodmen of the World, where it came popular was the Woodmen of the World basketball. Well, softball and basketball, because you were sponsoring teams back there to get the name out there.
Yeah.
And that's where it really hung on with me. And then, of course, in the, now June of 83, I remember going back and you had filmed the first softball games. And when 3 days later or whatever it was, actually tried to get them the next day, if I'm not mistaken.
Once I started in 86, I tried to get them on the same night. I couldn't always do that, depending on the time, but if not, it would be the next day.
Right, I mean, it was relatively quick that.
Yeah.
And that was kind of unique. I mean, of course, it was new. And seeing your local friends and family members playing softball or any sport or whatever doing.
On TV, yeah.
Yeah, it was kind of new. So here we are 30 years. It's 30 years in June.
Yeah.
So happy anniversary.
Well, it's too late. It's too late. We're on our way
belated.
To the 31st.
Belated. Belated happy birthday. How's that?
Okay.
So we're going to head to Plattsburgh to see Dale and Tim. And this was a real treat. We had a rare sighting. It was like a moose sighting here on Hometown Cable. And I don't mean that Calvin's the size of a moose, but we actually saw Calvin in front of the camera. And you don't see that too often. So we're going to head over to Plattsburgh down to Plattsburgh right now and talk to Dale and Tim. And we finally made it to Plattsburgh, and we're in Durkee Street, actually, and we're at the Woodmen of the World. And I got Dale Gagneau and Tim Gagneau, and you're the head one here for the Woodmen of the World, right?
I'm the area manager.
I know there's a title for it.
There's a title, yeah. Area manager.
And then, Tim, your role?
I am a district rep. They call them special reps now, but basically I work hand-in-hand with Dale.
Okay, so, and what's kind of neat for the folks looking at this, we are a room of cousins in here. Dale is my first cousin, Calvin's my first cousin, and then Tim and Dale are first cousins.
Yeah.
So a lot of family ties here.
Cousins.
Cousins.
Okay.
The Cousins.
Now, you've been the area manager for how many years now?
12 full years now.
12 full years. Now, did you start out as an area manager?
No, I started out as a field rep, and about 12 months later, they started to put me into management, and on the, I believe it was the 14th month, I became a manager.
Okay, and then Tim, how long have you been above?
I've been about six, going on 7 years now.
So you've been around that long too?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then how many reps are there in the area?
We have 9 that work out of this office.
Okay.
We have 2 that are actually over in Vermont, and then we have 3-4 up in the Champlain-Rogers Point area, 1 in Peru, and 2 out of Malone.
Okay, and that's their area that they work?
Well, New York State is the area, so we can go anywhere in New York State. We just try to, stay out of each other's client management. Mm-hmm. So.
Okay, and sometimes there must be some overlaps into towns.
There is,
and stuff,
yes.
I would assume.
Like so we can go anywhere in New York State, and most of us have a Vermont license.
Okay.
So we go to Vermont too.
All right, and 9 reps covering. Yeah, I know you can cover anywhere in New York State, but what really realistically is your market?
We used to, we try to go from, Malone back here to Ross Point, Chazy, Champlain, and then Lake George is probably the limit we go now. We used to go to Albany, but that takes a lot of driving time.
Mm-hmm.
So I like to stay with, if I'm hiring a field rep, I like to stay within 75 to 100 miles, so you're more, hands-on with them.
So you're going as far west as Malone?
Yes.
And then as far south as Glens Falls?
Yes.
Then, of course, we have the border and we have the lake. So that's your boundaries there.
Well, we can go anywhere in the state of New York, the state of Vermont. So mm-hmm. We have all of Vermont open to us.
Now, Tim, what area do you work the most?
Basically, I help out with the Vermont side.
Okay.
And I do a lot around home. So the big thing for me is, over the course of the last year, I've come home where I was in Vermont for about 2 years as an area manager. But, it's hard to build and get a team up and going, and then there's always something that happens. So I just decided after 2 years that it was best to come home, work with Dale, and we've done very, very well since. So, and we're still trying to build Vermont at the same time. So we're just doing it together.
So there's still a lot of room for growth.
Oh, there's tons of room. I mean, we haven't even begun to scratch the surface. And we work good together because I like being out with the people and seeing people.
Right.
That's the way I was brought up in the business. And Tim is the guy that keeps me straight and does all the administrative, so it works out really good. I hire him and hand him off to Tim.
Okay, that works out really well. Now, do you have any plans to add more people to the organization?
Yes, we always. I like 12.
You're at 9 now.
I'm at 9. I've been as high as 21. That's a little tough because you're never home.
Right.
But 12 to 14 people is a good mixture because you've always got 8 to 10 that's really hitting, because you got people like we got a new agent coming on this week, and the first 3 to 4 weeks is going to be nothing but product knowledge and getting them ready to go to Omaha. Mm-hmm. And that's where Tim comes in. He does all the computer training and all the inside training here in the office, and I go with them out once they've learned the basic knowledge. You really learn when you go out in the trenches, and that's where I go.
Okay, so you go out in the trenches with them?
Right.
Okay.
We're with them on every call, for about a period of 90 days. And, mm-hmm.
If he can't be out on a call, I'm out on a call with him. So, we're there to cover each other.
So you got
to
piggyback off each other.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So anybody watching this that is looking for work, you're always recruiting, I'm assuming, up to 12 or 14 people.
Well, we even go higher, but that's the magic number.
So if anybody's watching this and they think they might enjoy this line of work, give you guys a call and you can definitely talk to them, I'm sure.
Sure.
So why don't you talk a little bit about what Women of the World, what they are, what their mission is. And if you kind of share it with the folks, we've heard of Women of the World, but it'd be nice to hear from the inside what it's all about.
We'll let Tim do that because he's a phenomenal guy.
Okay.
Women of the World was founded in 1890 with a simple dual mission. We help protect American families, and we give people opportunities for community service. So It's a nice thing because we're out there doing the life insurance, doing the financial services, helping make sure that if something happens, people are taken care of. Mm-hmm. And if, you know, we want to retire, we want to make sure that the money's there to take care of that as well. I mean, at the same time, we get to do some great community service. I mean, the wall behind you is loaded with some of the things from the Chapter 462 that we've done. Lots and lots of different community things. We've got a murder mystery theater we've done now for 3 years, and that's coming back in November 8th and 9th.
Okay.
In Plattsburgh. It's going to be great. Going to be another fun time. And that all those proceeds go to Relay for Life. So we get to do all that nice stuff in the community.
Right.
But at the same time, you know, we're here to sell life insurance and financial services.
Okay. So yeah, and you're more than just life insurance.
Yes,
we
are.
I think we need to get that out there because my impression was that it was just life insurance.
No, we do the whole gamut. I mean, we look at the life cycle. Mm-hmm. We look at, you know, from the beginning to the end. As soon as we're born, we prepare for what? Death.
Sure.
And every one of us in this room has to agree on one thing: we're going to die.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the big thing today is with big business not doing full, you know, defined pensions anymore. We have the 401k. We also have to take and do a portion of that on ourselves to supplement.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the big thing today because we're all going to retire, hopefully.
Well, hopefully that's a goal for most of us.
It all comes down to retirement income and building that income in the accumulation phase, and then what do you do with it, and mm-hmm. and how do you make sure that income is set the way that you want it when the time comes to retire.
See, now I would assume that when you have your first meeting with a potential client, that really the first meeting is really a consultation.
All we do is gather information, and we might do 2-3 of those meetings. Gathering information, because the trick to this business is listening and giving people what they want
or what they need
and what they can reasonably afford. You know,
it's a
sin on my conscience if I put a person into a product that they can't really afford, and it's going to go down 3-6 to a year from now.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to, you know, guide people and show them that, you know, this is the right product for you,
right.
And can you reasonably afford it?
I think it's safe to say that when you have that consult with them, that, and I want to get this out, that you aren't there just to sell them a product, that you really want to tailor a program to their needs.
Absolutely. You want to make sure that you're taking care of the actual needs of the person.
Mm-hmm.
Not, you know, I want to sell this product. I want to make sure that your path is followed the proper way.
Sure. Sure. Now, once you get somebody as a client, do you have like annual reviews with them? Do you like every 3 years to see if they're on pace? I mean,
we try to make sure and see people, you know, and depending on the product, of course, and depending on the, you know, the what we're doing. If it's financial services, we speak to people a little bit more often.
Mm-hmm.
When it's life insurance, every year an annual review, a 6-month would be great.
Right.
But at the farthest, we want to go about 2 years.
Yeah, I would think so, because families change.
Families change. People have weddings,
babies,
different situations.
Sure.
Lots of times you run into these life changes that people don't think about their life insurance. People
sure.
don't think about, you know, what they've set aside and what they've set down, and it gets missed. And if that gets missed, problems can arise later.
I think probably one of the biggest mistakes that people make is that they don't realize exactly what they need, or if they have some kind of insurance, they think it's enough until something happens.
Or don't understand life insurance at all.
Right.
There's a lot of people that have no understanding of what life insurance is, and that's, you know, that's something that we'd like to change. You know, get out there and explain to people what it is, why it's important,
mm-hmm.
and how it can help not just the individual family, but businesses with key man insurance, mm-hmm. things of that nature, and you know, just so many different products to protect not only the individual but the business.
Well, I think a lot of people have a hard time because it's not a tangible product that they're purchasing.
Right.
It's
exactly.
Intangible, right? So you have to paint that picture for them as to why they should have it and why they need it. I mean, and it is important that people do have insurance for those big events, which can happen anytime.
That's right.
That we don't know. Now, if a person joins the Woodmen in the sense they have a policy with you or financial services, are they now a member of the lodge up in this area?
Yes.
Or are they two separate things?
Yeah. Once they purchase a core product from Woodmen Life Insurance Annuity, they become a member of Woodmen, and then there are benefits that go along with that. There's a whole list of member benefits, and then member discounts through that. So there's a lot of different things that come just with buying a policy.
Okay.
You get a whole lot of extra bang for your buck, I guess.
So, and you guys meet monthly, right, at
yes.
the lodge up in GC?
Yes, yes.
Okay,
yes.
Now is this a meeting that's opened up to the membership?
It's always open to the membership, and as many people who we can get in there we'll take, because it's different ideas
mm-hmm.
from different people, and the more people that get involved, the more of those types of things that we do, and you know, think outside the box and do something different.
Right. I know. I mean, you guys are obviously well known for handing out the flag
mm-hmm.
to different
mm-hmm.
organizations, and I assume that you still do that.
Oh yes.
Yes. Yeah.
And so, how many in the course of a year, how many flags would you say you'd be giving out?
Oh boy, Woodmen as a whole in the hundreds of thousands, but here locally, I would say over 100 at different times and different sizes, different.
Sure.
Different. We've done whole school systems. We've done. We've just donated 500 small flags, and then the lodge in Plattsburgh donated 500 small handheld flags for the Battle of Plattsburgh.
Oh, nice.
We'll be at Culver Hill this weekend for a flagpole dedication that we donated.
Right.
So it's not just flags; it's flagpoles and any kind of flag that you can think of. If it's available, we'll get a hold of it and we'll present it.
Well, I'm sure a lot of people watching this probably never didn't realize what just came out here. Now, how all these donations, do these people approach you, or do you get wind of something and you approach them?
It's a little of both.
A little of both.
You know, if we see a flag that doesn't look very good, we may make the offer.
Okay.
You know, if we see a flag flying over a public building and it's a little ragged, we might stop in. A lot of the towns kind of know now, and we'll get a call and hey, I need a 5x8 or I need a 4x6, and we do that. Schools, churches.
And I'm sure if you do see a flag that's not at its best, you probably educate them somewhat, probably in a nice way, on the proper way to display a flag.
The easiest way to do that is to offer them a nice new flag and leave it at that. But we do actually have books, the flag etiquette books,
okay.
Patriot handbooks that we hand out to schools and organizations.
Right.
So those are all nice and helpful for that too.
Now, do you ever talk to the people on the proper way to dispose of a flag?
We have a gentleman in Ticonderoga that actually puts on classes, goes into schools and does that.
Mm-hmm.
So the Plattsburgh Lodge, we lean on him quite a bit.
Sure.
We donate, you know, flags to him and, you know, the handbooks and stuff like that.
And I'm sure a lot of people don't realize there is a proper
right.
way to dispose of the American flag.
Yes.
You know, it's obviously the great symbol of our country. So.
And that's one of the things in that little handbook. I mean, if you don't know, you just got to go to that and
right.
step by step.
And those handbooks, you guys offer those handbooks?
Yes,
we do.
Okay.
Yes.
So now if somebody wanted to contact you here at the office, okay, why don't you give the address here at the Durkee Street office and then how to contact you?
It's 43 Durkee Street, Suite 200. Now you just come in the building and come straight back past the elevator. We're right there.
Okay.
In fact, this was the old hospice office.
Oh, this was? Okay.
This was the old hospice office.
Okay.
And the phone number is 518-561-7213.
And then I'm sure you must have a web page.
Woodmen.org.
Okay,
yeah, that's the main web page, and you
okay.
can actually find our individual web pages on there.
Okay. So, anything you want to add, Dale? We've covered a few things here, but
I guess you know the big thing right now is a lot of people don't realize that. You know, I tell my field reps and the people I get in front of that every one of us that carries an insurance certificate or in the business world an insurance policy, we are all underinsured right now. because we have to talk to people at the guaranteed interest rate of 1%. So if we have to supplement $50,000 worth of income in a family when one of the loved ones dies, that means they need $5 million worth of insurance. And, you know, like I tell people, that's a perfect picture. But in today's world, we have to take and find a way to offset that.
Right.
Because, you know, people will go out and have insurance on the car. There's probably 3% to 100 that they're going to take and get in that accident. Long-term care is another big thing, and there's about 73% of the people today will need long-term care. And, you know, that's offered through us, through our sister company, Woodmen Insurance. But these are things that people just don't realize, that there's no more backup today. Our government is, you know, cut things way right, back sure. on us. So if we don't prepare for ourselves, and, you know, the best time to sell insurance is when you're 25 and 30.
Right. But now, when you're saying $5 million, are you talking about having $5 million in death benefit?
Right.
Yeah, because, I mean, that is a number that I would never even think of. I mean,
And that sounds scary, but when you, you know, if they buy it at the right age and you're buying term insurance, it doesn't matter. Like I tell people, if I bring you a check for $50,000 or $100,000 or $200,000, whatever that is, doesn't matter if it came from term insurance or whole life insurance or universal life. So we urge people to go out and see their representatives, go out and see the people that they're doing business with, and do these checkups, because it will scare you today that everybody is underinsured.
Yeah, I mean, growing up in the 70s and 80s, right. I mean, going through, I mean, it was not uncommon to get a $25,000 policy, a $50,000 policy, almost unheard of for a $100,000 policy.
Scary.
Yeah, so when you start talking millions, it really has changed.
And I sit back here now, I can remember I was about 16 years old when I bought my first policy from Mel Franklin in Rouse's Point, and, you know, he would walk the streets of Rouse's Point with that book, and, you know, he was a $1 million agent.
Back then?
Back then. What would he be today?
$10 million, that's right. Probably.
So it's, you know, the thing of it is, you have to take and ask for the appointment. You have to take and open people's minds.
Mm-hmm.
We, you know, if we sell the sizzle of what this product can do for you, it's the easiest thing in the world to sell. If you go in and ask somebody to buy life insurance, they're going to say no to you.
Sure.
But if I was to ask you today, if you were to die tonight, would your family be taken care of? I'm going to stop you in your tracks.
Right. Yeah.
You know, and everybody wants interest. And when you get into the financial products and you start to distribute that out, there's the accumulation period and the distribution. When you get to the distribution, I mean, you know, you got to have a payment that's going to take and make it right for you.
Mm-hmm.
But if you don't have anything, you're going to end up with nothing.
Right.
So, you know, it's
so I assume that when you do this for your consultation, I'm sure, but it may be a combination of products that will get you to where you need to be.
Yes, definitely.
Whether it's whole life, universal, whether it's, would you say the first one you said?
Term
insurance.
What's amazing is nowadays you're in a situation where, you know, let's say we need $100,000. Well, you can put we can put that into our computer, and I can probably give you 15 price points for $100,000 worth of insurance. We can go all the way down to term, or we can go up. There's a no lapse guarantee product. There is, and then there's of course whole life, which is the which is the Cadillac. So it's whatever price point and whatever goal a person has in mind. So
sure.
A term life insurance policy will take care of the death benefit over a period of time.
Sure.
We have the no lapse guarantee that, you know, it's like a term, but it grows a little bit of cash value so that it'll take you to a certain age.
Mm-hmm.
So we can go to 80, 100, 120 now, because that's when, you know, little ones who are being born today, they think they're going to live to 120. Those are what the tables say from the actuaries.
Right.
So there's all sorts of different ways. And then you might take 25,000 of that as a whole life product, have that there for the rest of your life. and the rest in term to cover the need for the period of time. So that there's so many different ways to do what we do. It's just a matter of being able to figure out exactly what it is and tailoring it to that particular person.
Right. So, I mean, it's so the point is it can be complicated, and that's what you need a professional like you guys for, to sit down and analyze this for the people.
But the, you know, I tell this to people, you know what the best product is on the market? It's the one that's going to pay at the time of need.
Right.
And it doesn't matter if it's a term or a universal life or a whole life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's what's going to pay you at, you know, pay your beneficiary at the time of need.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where we actually go to work then.
Right.
Because, you know, once we deliver that death payment, we have to find ways to supplement that income that was coming in.
Sure.
So that's when we really go to work.
Okay. So, I mean, then of course, we're talking about the ultimate when the time does come for all of us.
Right.
But then you also talked about retirement. So you have financial products for the retirement aspect of it, right?
Right.
Do you want to kind of expand on that a little bit?
We have a full line of mutual funds, all of the major companies we have access to. We have our own brokerage account. Woodmen Financial has a brokerage account that, you know, you can do any mixture of any of that. And we also are involved with variable annuities, which, you know, some of those can be really set well for income. Others, you know, there's some great features all the way around in all of these different products.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, one of the things that we pride ourselves on is whether you've got $1,200 or $5,000 that you're rolling over from a 401k or $100,000, we want to talk to you. We want to take care of you. We believe that everybody deserves the same opportunity, and we want to make sure that, you know, people are taken care of. So that's kind of part of what we do is no matter how much, and if you just want to start out, we'll do it as low as $50 a month to get started.
So I mean, and I know people they know too, they can get insurance anywhere. Mm-hmm. You know, why the Woodmen of the World experience?
Well, I tell this to everybody I sit in front of, that the products that I sell and the products we offer in the financial end, you can buy at any bank, you can buy at any corner. We are there for the full gamut. We're going to take care of you from the beginning to the end. And, you know, the big thing is you've got to get back to these people, and it's hard. We don't have enough fuel reps. We're trying now. We're having a big, I guess you could call it a bonanza, that we're trying to see people every 2 years because of what's happening in the marketplace.
Mm-hmm.
So,
but I'd say service is a big part of it.
What it comes down to is service. Is can we offer you service? Do we take care of you when you need it? And mm-hmm. and that's what we offer. Mm-hmm. You know,
what value are you putting on the table for that customer that's sitting across from you,
mm-hmm.
or that member? And, you know, I tell all my people, if you're going to go in there selling from the hip, don't walk in the door. If you're going to go in and bring value to the table, they're going to listen to you.
Right. But and I like your approach, because that is the proper approach. Because I've seen it through the years, experiences where people would come in to have an appointment with you, and you can tell they're there just for their own personal gain and need. You can just read it. They're just trying to sell you a product. And then you have it where people come in and do what you're talking about, having a consultation to really understand your needs, wants, and desires. And they tailor a program to it. And that approach is obviously the only approach.
I never worry about how much I'm going to make,
mm-hmm.
when I'm sitting and talking to somebody. I'm worried about how I can solve that problem.
Right.
The money comes.
I mean, right,
we don't worry about that, because it's going to be there. But, you know, it's all about what that problem is, how can we solve it, how do we make sure that they get where they need to be and they have what they need.
Yeah, I my philosophy that I work by is I don't worry about my needs. If I truly believe I can sincerely and personally take care of your needs, mine will be taken care of. But I got to take care of your needs first. And you guys obviously have the same approach.
You know, when we go into to a meeting and we sit down, and, you know, I train the new people in the field, and we tell them there's really three things we want to accomplish tonight. We want to tell you a little bit about Woodmen. We want to tell you a little bit about us, but more important, we want to know a whole lot about you.
Mm-hmm.
And you turn that over to that member or that client, and they go.
Right.
And you've got all the information you need, and then you start to you know, hone in on different things that they've said. And like I said, it might take 2-3 appointments mm-hmm. before you get it right down to what they want, because we go in and we change people's lives, whether we sell them a fixed product from Woodmen or else we go out into the market and sell them a securities product. We change people's lives.
Absolutely, you do.
In that first meeting, it has to be a conversation. It has to be a fact-finding about them and mm-hmm. and what they need. And then the product is, that's easy. We figure that out afterward.
Right.
It's really finding out what they need and what they want.
Yeah, and what I'm trying to get in this conversation to the folks out here is that you really tailor this to their personal needs.
Every need is different. Mm-hmm. There's not one certificate out there. We might sell a lot of this one particular product or that product, but every need is tapered and set up for what that need of that family is.
Exactly. Now, this has been very, very interesting. Tim, you want to add anything else to what we've talked about so far today?
Just basically, we're here to help. That's why we're here. We love doing what we were doing. Woodmen of the World is a great organization. It's a great thing to be a part of. We urge people to contact us and learn more about what we can do, because mm-hmm. you'd be surprised at all the different things that we offer to our members on top of the service that we offer. And the products are, they're top rate, and we get into everything and make sure that it's a tailored situation for every person.
Now, you had said earlier, I think Woodmen of the World is like in the 1800s, late 1800s?
1890.
And in this area, I think Calvin said mid-70s?
75.
So they have a 38-year track history here. Definitely. In our area. So, I mean, and obviously a very solid organization. But while I'm at it, since I have these two young gentlemen here, is we want to talk about Hometown Cable, and I think you guys are in agreement that, and I say this to Calvin all the time, and he kind of chuckles at it, but he's one of our North Country treasures, and he's evolved to that point. It's been over 30 years. It was June of 83 that Calvin started this, and it actually started through the Woodmen of the World. We talked about this on the camera when we were down at the lodge, that it actually came out, the Access Channel was coming on, and he approached the lodge about, hey, let's start some things or shows about parades and stuff like that to promote the lodge, and here we have more 30 years into the future. And Calvin is capturing the North Country. He's capturing our history. He's capturing the people of the North Country. Our kids, our grandkids down the road will get access to this, and they'll go, wow, look at those guys back then, and so it's new to us today, but it will be history now. I don't know, when we leave here, it starts becoming history, I guess.
Right.
But Calvin can't do this by himself, and so we're making an appeal to the people out there that are watching this, and hopefully we've compelled you, and hopefully you've really enjoyed this show today to realize the importance of making sure that your personal needs are taken care of at home. But we got to support Calvin. I say we got to. It would be nice if you could. It would be nice if you would. But if you want to send a donation to Calvin, it's at 1477 Ridge Road in Champlain, New York, 12919. Or you go to the Hometown Cable Network. .com. You can pay through the PayPal account, but Calvin pays for the Access Channel. He pays for his equipment, his gas, his time. It is his livelihood. There's no doubt about it. But if you want something of value, we have to pay for it. And a lot of people of you have through the years. There's a lot of consistent people that we see when Calvin posts who has donated. And there are some newcomers coming on. And obviously, Calvin does appreciate the people that do it monthly or even once a year or once. He appreciates that. And but hopefully you've seen this, and if you're the first time and you've watched this for years and you really like what you see, send a donation to Calvin. It's money. I don't even call it spent money. I call it money invested. It's money invested into the North Country, into the people, the businesses. Our segment's called Talkin' Business, and we do this to promote your business, to let people support local business, because I know firsthand, if you support local business, you support the community back by giving back in many different ways, and it just makes for a stronger community when we all support each other. So that's my infomercial for you, Calvin, on this show here. And so, guys, this has been a great, great show. I appreciate you taking time out of your day, because I know you're both busy people. And as you said, you don't have enough people, and you got to get out and see your clientele.
We will never have enough people.
But, taking time out of your day to share what you do to the people of the North Country, I think has been very, very beneficial. And And we always get good feedback from this show, and hopefully you guys get some feedback too, with people wanting to sit down with you and really taking their life seriously and getting their life in order, I guess is probably a proper way of putting it. But Tim and Dale, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm Joey Trombley. Calvin Castein, the founding father of Hometown Cable, is right behind me. And I got to say this before I sign off. I said this down at the lodge. I said we had a rare moose sighting. I said we had Calvin in front of the camera. Not because he's big. It's just that you never see Calvin. He's always behind the camera. So he was actually in front of the camera, which was kind of cool. So I'm Joey Trombley, along with Calvin, Tim, and Dale. This has been another edition of Talkin' Business.